When I say neuroscience, I could guess that your first thought isn't crime or courts of law. However, thanks to the ever-changing advances in technology, this relatively contemporary science has been used to not only reinforce guilty verdicts or help prove someone's innocence, it has at times been utilized to keep some of the most vicious of criminals alive, safeguarded from the death penalty. This is Dynamic Science, and today we have a dreadfully interesting topic for you: neuroscience in the court of law. Over the past few decades, the reach of neuroscience has gone beyond research labs and clinics into courtrooms to help maintain truth and justice. The very first introduction of neuroscience into the courtroom can be traced back to the 1940s, when an electroencephalogram, EEG, was first used in a case involving a defendant with epilepsy. Lawyers used the technology to make a case against laws that denied rights to individuals with a neurological disorder. Since then, the use of neuroscientific evidence in court has increased exponentially. A 2015 analysis by Deno identified 800 neuroscience-involved criminal cases over 20 years. Now that is a lot, considering neuroscience and the technologies supporting it are themselves quite new. We are going to talk about a few of the more well-known cases where brain scans were presented as evidence in court to defend a perpetrator. And to kick us off, I cannot think of one better than my favorite, the United States versus John Hinckley Jr. On March 30, 1981, John Hinckley shot the President of the United States, Ronald Reagan, and three others outside a Washington, D.C. hotel. The following year, he went on trial, and in frustration, literally said, "My brain made me do it." Jokes aside, in the trial, Hinckley's defense attorneys argued that their client was ill with a narcissistic personality disorder, citing neuroscientific evidence to support it. Now, this may begin to sound like a movie script, but his lawyers quite seriously argued that Hinckley had a pathological obsession with the 1976 film Taxi Driver, in which the main character attempts to assassinate a fictional politician. His lawyers claimed that Hinckley was obsessed with the lead actress Jodie Foster and had attempted to reenact the film to impress the actress. To everyone's surprise, Hinckley was found not guilty by reason of insanity and was sent to a government psychiatric hospital instead of a prison. He was fully released from the hospital quite recently in 2016 and now works in an antique shop hoping to sell his artwork through Etsy. John Hinckley, assassinator turned artist. Another popular case is that of Steven Stenko, who killed two people and raped a teenage girl in South Carolina. When he was charged with murder, his lawyers admitted PET scans as proof he had an injury from birth that affected his reasoning abilities. Although the neuroscientific evidence did not help him much, as of now, his case is on appeal, with the possibility of more scans being presented in court. Over the past decade, there has been numerous amounts of research into the link between physical abnormalities in the brain and criminal or psychotic behavior. By performing brain scans, scientists have found that prisoners with psychopathic traits had significantly smaller amounts of gray matter in regions associated with processing empathy, moral reasoning, and emotional intelligence. Professionals within both fields have conflicting opinions on the viability of neuroscientific evidence being used in the courtroom. Can this be normalized? Is it possible that homicidal behavior is biologically based, nature's influence, and abnormalities in the brain should be used to lessen the sentence of a perpetrator's crime, no matter how monstrous? Or do you think that biology plays a less significant role, and it is the social and conditioning aspects, nurture, that dominates? Therefore, neuroscientific evidence should not hold power in courtrooms. Internet warriors, I will leave that up to you. comment your thoughts below as if it is an intellectual battlefield, and let us know your views on the use of neuroscientific evidence in a court of law. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to our channel for your weekly dose of dynamic science.